Hi everyone, so welcome to this new Unity tutorial series where I'll be teaching you how to create a roguelike like Vampire Survivors. So, if you guys didn't know already, Vampire Survivors is a pretty popular 2D roguelike shoot'em up game where you are the bullet hell basically. And yeah, let's just dive right in. But before we do that, I'm gonna explain the goal for this tutorial series, or the goals more specifically. So the first goal for this tutorial series is to make it as easy to follow as possible. I basically want to allow anyone from all skill levels to be able to follow this tutorial smoothly at their own pace without feeling overwhelmed. The second and, well, the more important goal is to basically make it as expandable and scalable as possible. This is such that when the tutorial series ends, you, the viewer, won't have any trouble with continuing the game by populating it with more weapons, enemies, and even characters if you wish to do so. Now, without further ado, let's dive right into the first part. So by the end of the first part, you should have something like this, where you will have player movement set up, player animation set up, and last but not least, a camera to follow the player. Alright, so first let's set up our project. So the first thing we have to do is open up Unity Hub and create a 2D project using the core template. I'll be using the Unity Editor version 2020.3.33f1 for this tutorial series, but you can use any that you want. However, I do recommend using a version similar to or later than the one I'm using because some features might be missing if you are using an earlier version. And once that's done, just key in the project name and create project. Now that we have our project up and running, the first thing we want to do is create some structure to store our future files. As a start, I created the art, prefabs, and scripts folders. And also, I changed the name of the project sample scene to a better name like game, because it just sounds better. Now let's create some movement for our player character. But before we can do that, we need to first download and set up an asset. So we'll be using the character sprite sheet that I found within a package I found on itch.io. You can find the link to that in the description below. All we have to do is just drag this character sprite sheet into the art folder we just created, and yeah. Once that's done, we need to slice this sprite sheet. To do that, we just need to click on the sprite sheet and look towards the inspector window. Over here, you can see a couple of things that we need to change. First up is the sprite mode. We have to change this to multiple because Unity will not allow us to slice the sheet if it's not set to multiple. And secondly, we need to change the pixels to unit to 25 to basically just enlarge it. I found that 25 is the best size, but if you want to change it to like 32, you may do so as well. Alright, next thing we need to change is the filter mode. Change it to point no filter to basically just make our pixels blocky. I always recommend using this option when you're working with pixel art as it gives you the best looking pixel art. Alright, so after that, just click apply and yeah, we're done. Afterwards, we need to click on the sprite editor, and it should bring up this sprite editor window. If you do not have this sprite editor window, it means you did not install the package. And afterwards, at the bottom left corner, or the top left corner, sorry, click on slice and change the type to automatic if it isn't already. Afterwards, just hit slice at the bottom of the pop-up. Okay, so now that you should be able to see that your sprites have been sliced. To confirm this change, just click apply at the top right and close out of the window afterwards. If you've done everything correctly, now you should be able to see that your sprite sheet in the project window should look like this. Like, yes, an arrow, and then, yeah, it's just sliced sprites. Yep, which means you did it correctly. Great. Now it's time to create a player object. Drag and drop one of the sprites from our player sprite sheet onto the scene and rename it to player. I'll be using the right-facing one, which is the 48 sprite, also called the player sprite sheet underscore 48. And afterwards, let's head into our scripts folder that we created previously and right-click, create C# script. Let's call the script player movement. Now, there are a lot of ways to handle 2D movement in Unity. You can directly translate things, use the built-in physics engine, and even use an external library from the asset store. But for us, we're going to be using Unity's built-in physics engine as I find it the most reliable. In order to do that, we need to add a rigid body 2D to our player, and while we're here, let's also add a box collider 2D for the future and our player movement script that we just created. Let's also expand the constraints tab under the rigid body 2D component and make sure freeze rotation on the Z-axis is checked. This will stop our player from spinning later on when they bump into objects like enemies in the future. Now when you hit the play button, by default you should be able to see that our player just falls into the abyss. Now this is because the gravity scale on its rigid body is just set to 1. And basically what this will mean is just that the player has gravity. And usually what we do in this situation to disable its gravity is just set this number to 0. Like so. But since our entire game is top down and doesn't really need gravity anyway, instead of disabling the gravity for only our player, why not we just disable the gravity for our entire game such that future objects created with a rigid body 3D won't have gravity as well. This will save us the hassle of having to change it each time. To do so, let's go under the project settings window by clicking on Edit at the top left corner, Project Settings, and Physics 2D. Now, under the Physics 2D tab, set the gravity to 0. And yeah, make sure it is the Physics 2D tab and not Physics tab. And just set this Y value to 0. Okay, great. Now when you exit out of this tab and hit the play button once again, you can see that our player doesn't fall even though the rigid body 2D's gravity scale is still set to 1. So let's just open up our player movement script that we created previously. And in here, we want to start by creating a few variables. The first of which will be a public float called MoveSpeed to define the speed of our player. The second will be a rigid body 2D called RB, which we'll use as a reference. The third will be a vector 2 called MoveDir, which we'll use to check the direction our player is moving. And now we want to create a reference for the rigid body 2D component we place on the player. So let's do so in the start function. We want to now create two new functions. One is to process all our inputs, so we can name it input management. Second is to handle movement, so let's name it move. Alright, so now in our input management function, we want to create a we want to check for the horizontal and vertical axes. But if you're not too sure that what that means, you can head over to the project settings and input manager. So you can expand these axes and you're able to see the horizontal and vertical among a bunch of other axes. We'll just be using this to make our player move. Now you can customize the buttons however you want over here, but for simplicity's sake, let's keep it the same. Moving on, in our input management function, let's create two new floats, a move x and move y, and set them to their respective axes. In this case, we should use the input.getAxisRaw to get a value between 0 and 1 to just tell which buttons are being pressed. Now, what we can do is to set our move there after we process the inputs like so. And now in our move function, we can just apply the velocity to the rigid body. Now in our update function, we can call the input management function, but as for the move function, we have to create a fixed update first. And the reason why we're using a fixed update for the move function is simply because the fixed update is more suited for physics calculation, as it calls in regular intervals and it's not based on frame rate like with regular update. So let's head back to the inspector, head back to the editor, and before hitting the play button, make sure to set the move speed parameter in the inspector. Now using the WASD keys, you should be able to move your player around. Alright, so in this section, we'll be handling player animation. And the first thing we have to do is to create a new script under our scripts folder called the player animator. We'll be using this script to handle all our player animations. And don't forget to add the script to the player as well. Now we need to create some animations for our player. In our art folder, let's create a subfolder called animations to hold all our animations. Now we just need to open up the animation and animator windows by heading over to window at the top of the editor, animation and animator and animation. Now once they're open, head over to the animation window and select the player in your hierarchy. Click the create button that shows up on the window and yeah, your Windows Explorer should show up. And navigate to our animations folder that we created previously, and once there we just have to change the name to player walk. And yeah, so this animation will be used for all our player movement. Now drag and drop sprites 48 to 52 onto the animation timeline. So now when you click on the play button within the animation window, you should be able to see that the player is now walking, albeit a bit too fast. To fix this, let's change the sample rate to 12. Now, if you do not see the sample rate option like I have right here, head over to the three dots on the top right of the animation window and click it. Make sure show sample rate is enabled. This one here. Okay, now we need to configure the animator. open up your animator window and still with your player selected, right click on the empty space within the window and create state empty. Rename this empty state to idle right before right clicking it and setting as default state. So this state will be used whenever our player isn't walking around. Now next we need to right click on the idle state and create transition with the arrow, click on the player walk and do the same for the opposite as well. Now head over to the left side of the window and hit the plus sign and create a bool called move. So this will be used to check whether or not our player is moving and if the player walk animation should play. So click on the arrow transitioning from the idle to player walk state and add a new condition. Make sure the move condition is set to true as we only want the animation to play when the player is moving. Next, let's disable has exit time and expand the settings tab. Follow my settings as shown here to eliminate all exit time. This is done in order to make sure the movement is as snappy as possible. Let's also do the same for the other transition arrow from player walk to idle. Just make sure that the move condition this time is set to false instead of true. Alright, great. Now we can proceed to some code. Alright, now starting off in our player animator script, we need three references. One is a reference to the animator component, two is a reference to our player movement script, and three is a reference to the sprite renderer component. Next, in our update function, we should check if the x or y values of the move turn player movement is 0. But in order to do so, we need to public the variable first to access it. Head into our player movement script and set the move turn to public. We should also add a height in inspector attribute so that we don't get confused and assume it's a parameter we set in the inspector. It's also a good practice to keep our inspector clean. Now, we want to head back into our player animator script. And what we want to do is to check whether or not our player is moving by checking if the x or y values of the move their vector are set to 0. If they are, that means they are not moving, and if they are not, means they are moving and we should turn on our animation. Now when you play the game, you'll be able to see that the player animation turns on while the player is moving and turns off while it is not. Great! But if you couldn't already tell, there's a huge issue. Currently, our sprite and animation is only facing the right, even when we are walking towards the left. So let's create a function called sprite direction tracker and call it underneath the animation set bool true. So we'll be using this function to just flip the player sprite and make it face the correct direction. Inside this function, we should check if our sprite is facing the left or right using the x value of the move there and flip it to face the correct direction. So if the x value is more than 0, it means the player is facing the right, and if it's less than that, it means the player is facing the left. And now when you move towards the left and right, you can see that the player faces the correct direction, which is, awesome. But there is still one issue with this. If you couldn't tell already, if you're facing the left and walk upwards or downwards, the sprite immediately flips back to the right. Now the problem is because the move there depends on the move x and move y variables, and that reads the input every single frame because it's on the update function. That means that when there isn't any input, the move value for the x immediately becomes 0, and well, the animation just defaults. Now to fix this, we have to create a way to store our last input. Create two variables called last horizontal vector and last vertical vector and set them to public. So like with the move there, let's also set them hidden with the inspector. Now all we have to do is to just set these variables to be equal to their respective values as long as they are not 0. This is very important because we want to store the last value input before the movement stops and not the movement itself. Alright, so now let's head back into our player animator and change from using the move.x in the sprite direction checker to the last horizontal vector. And yeah, let's play the game and start walking around and everything should work just fine. So far, we've created the movement and animation for our player, so it's time we get the last order of business for this part, camera. So since this is a top-down game, you could just drag the main camera onto the player and call it a day. But I don't really like this practice because you're actually limiting the camera in the long run, and it is always good practice to never put the main camera under the player unless it is for a very good reason. With that said, start by creating a script called camera movement and adding it onto our main camera. Inside there, we really only need to do three things, the first of which is to create a public transform called target to reference whatever we are tracking. In this case, it is our player. Secondly, we create a public vector3 called offset to give our camera some flexibility, and set the position of the camera to be the target.position plus offset. Now back in the editor, make sure you set the target to the player. And now when you hit play, you'll immediately see that your player just kind of disappears. Now this is because the main camera's Z position over here is set to 0, which means it is 0 units away from our player and it won't show up on camera. To fix this, all we have to do is to modify the offset parameter that we created in the inspector and set the Z to minus 10, which is the default for any 2D camera in Unity. And now when we hit play, you can see that the camera follows the player around nicely in the scene view, and if you like, you could even tweak the X and Y values of the offset to get it suited to your liking. So that's all for this part. In this part, we went through how to create movement, animation, and camera for our player. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next part. Bye!